Welcome to the Bloomington Center for the Arts. Really happy to see you here tonight. I'm Andrea Specht. I'm the Executive Director of Artistry, and we're one of seven organizations, arts organizations, based here in this building. Our programming includes all of the exhibitions that are in the center's galleries, including the amazing Sinew show. I know that tonight is, how can I say, a very momentous night with a lot going on. So we really are honored that you have chosen to spend part of your evening with us here for what we know will be an incredible discussion. Sinew was curated for Artistry by Dyani Whitehawk Polk as our contribution to the Guerrilla Girls Twin Cities takeover. As many of you know, the Guerrilla Girls has been exposing sexism and racism in the art world, politics, and pop culture for over 30 years. Disguised in gorilla masks, these anonymous artists and activists challenge stereotypes and the status quo with no holds barred honesty and wit. And I have to say, we had a preview that we would have the pleasure of being joined tonight by two gorilla girls in the flesh, so we hope that they will make an appearance. We expect that we may see Frida Kahlo and Kata Kolvitz, so we'll all anticipate that entrance. I'd also like to thank Dyani for being such a great collaborator, instigator, source of inspiration. And finally, our thanks go to all of the artists participating in this exhibit for sharing your work with us. It has really been an honor for us to bring this show to the Center for the Arts. Our panelists tonight include Jill Alberg Yo, Dyani Whitehawk Polk, Heid Erdrich, Andrea Carlson, Elizabeth Day, Louise Erdrich, and our moderator, Carrie Morgan. So with your patience, these are extremely accomplished artists, and I'm going to walk through these introductions so we can get to know them a little bit better. Jill Alberg Yo is Assistant Curator of Native American Art at the Minneapolis Institute of Art. Jill arrived at MIA in 2014, having previously served as Assistant Curator and Mellon Fellow of Native American Art at the St. Louis Art Museum. There, she installed the museum's first three permanent galleries of Native American art and collaborated with Lakota artist Arthur Amiot and Crow artist Wendy Redstar to bring a Native understanding to works from their respective communities. Jill grew up in rural Pennsylvania, received her BA from the University of Maryland, and studied anthropology for her MA at the University of New Mexico. For her PhD, also from the University of Mexico, Jill focused on Navajo textiles, learning the Navajo language and living on the vast Navajo reservation for 4.5 years. Among her initiatives at MIA are showcasing Native Minnesota artists, highlighting the art of Native women, and bringing Native perspectives to bear on the museum's collection. Sinew curator Dyani Whitehawk Polk lives in Shakopee. She is Sikongu Lakota, an enrolled member of the Rosebud Sioux tribe. Dyani earned an MFA in Studio Arts in 2011 from the University of Wisconsin-Madison and a BFA in Two-Dimensional Studio Arts in 2008 from the Institute of American Indian Arts in Santa Fe, New Mexico. From 2011 to 2015, she served as the gallery director and curator of All My Relations Gallery in Minneapolis. In March 2015, she transitioned into a full-time studio practice. Dyani is a recipient of the 2015 Native Arts and Culture Regional Native Arts and Cultures Regional Fellowship, 2014 Joan Mitchell Foundation Painters and Sculptors Grant, 2013-14 McKnight Visual Artists Fellowship, and 2012 Southwestern Association of Indian Arts Discovery Fellowships. She has participated in cultural exchange residencies in South Africa, Botswana, and Australia. She is an award-winning artist, earning Best of Division and First Place prizes at the 2012 and 2013 Santa Fe Indian Art Market and Best of Classification at the Santa Fe Indian Art Market in 2011. Dyani's works have been acquisitioned into the collections of the Smithsonian National Museum of the American Indian, Tweed Museum of Art, Okta Lakota Museum, the University of Wisconsin-Madison's Wisconsin Union Art Collection, and the Robert Penn Collection of Contemporary Northern Plains Indian Art of the University of South Dakota, as well as many organizational and private collections. She is represented by Shiprock, Santa Fe, and the Boakley Gallery in Minneapolis. Sinew exhibiting artist Heid E. Erdrich is author of four collections of poetry, including Cell Traffic, New and Selected Poems, published in 2012. Her most recent book is a nonfiction work, Original Local, Indigenous Foods, Stories, and Recipes from the Upper Midwest, published in 2013. Her writing has won awards from the Minnesota State Arts Board, Bush Foundation, the Loft Literary Center, and First Peoples Fund. Her book, National Monuments, won the 2009 Minnesota Book Award. In 2013, Heid was named a City Pages Artist of the Year. Her poem films have been screened widely at festivals and have won a Judges Award, a Best of Fest, and a Best Experimental Short Award. She is an independent scholar and curator, a playwright, and founding publisher of Wigwaz Press, an Ojibwe language publisher. Heid teaches in the MFA Creative Writing Program of Augsburg College. She grew up in Wahpeton, North Dakota, and is Ojibwe enrolled at Turtle Mountain. Sinew exhibiting artist Andrea Carlson is a Minneapolis-St. Paul-based painter. She earned a BA from the University of Minnesota in 2003 and an MFA from the Minneapolis College of Art and Design in 2005. Andrea has exhibited at the Minneapolis Institute of Art, October Gallery in London, NMAI at the George Gustav Hay Center in New York, the Venice Biennale, the Power Plant in Toronto, the Plains Art Museum in Fargo, and the Plug-In Institute for Contemporary Art in Winnipeg. She is the recipient of 2 Minnesota State Arts Board fellowships and 2 McKnight Foundation MCAD fellowships. Andrea's work also belongs to prominent collections, including the Weissman Art Museum, the British Museum, and the National Gallery of Canada. Elizabeth Day, Ojibwe, is a filmmaker from Minneapolis, Minnesota. Born on the Leech Lake Reservation and raised in the Twin Cities, Day blends her Native American heritage with her urban upbringing to create films that employ traditional Ojibwe-style storytelling while using contemporary filmmaking techniques. Her work often explores the tension between traditional Native teachings and the life of a modern urban Indian. Louise Erdrich is an Ojibwe writer of novels, poetry, and children's books featuring Native American characters and settings. She is an enrolled member of the Turtle Mountain Band of Chippewa Indians, a band of the Anishinaabe, also known as Ojibwe and Chippewa. Erdrich is widely acclaimed as one of the most significant writers of the second wave of Native American Renaissance. In 2009, her novel, The Plague of Doves, was a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize for Fiction and also received an Anisfield Wolf Book Award. In November 2012, she received the National Book Award for Fiction for her novel, The Roundhouse. And greetings to our Gorilla Girls in the flesh. In September 2015, she was also awarded the Library of Congress Prize for American Fiction at the National Book Festival. Louise Erdrich is also the owner of Birch Bark Books, a small independent bookstore in South Minneapolis that focuses on Native American literature and the Native community in the Twin Cities. And last but not least, moderator Carrie Morgan. Carrie Morgan, there you are. Is director of gallery and exhibition programs at the Minneapolis College of Art and Design. As part of her responsibilities at MCAD, she oversees 2 prestigious fellowship programs for Minnesota artists, the Jerome Foundation Fellowships for Emerging Artists and the McKnight Fellowships for Visual Arts. She also currently serves on the board of the Soap Factory. Carrie received a BA in art history and history from Smith College and her MA and PhD in art history from the University of Kansas. She was previously a curatorial assistant in the departments of prints and drawings and contemporary art at the Cantor Art Center at Stanford University, the curator of collections at the Cranart Art Museum at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign, and most recently the gallery and exhibits coordinator at Augsburg College. Carrie is a member of the collaborative team who initiated and organized the Gorilla Girls Twin Cities Takeover. Whew. Okay, there we are. So again, congratulations and thank you to all of you for participating in this wonderful exhibit and being with us tonight. And thank you all for being here. And at this point, I'm going to turn it over to Carrie.
Thank you very much for the nice introduction. And thank you for the invitation to be here this evening. It is an important night for all Americans who like to vote. And I must say that if I wasn't caucusing, which I'm not because I'm here, but the only reason is because this is really an important panel discussion to have. And I'm really honored to have even been invited to moderate. This is an illustrious group of artists who happen to be women and who happen to be Native, many of them. But at the same time, as I say, it's really an honor to be here. So thanks for all the work that went into this. So I guess I'm going to start with some good questions and hopefully just get the ball rolling because there's so much material and so much depth to the work that's on view that I look forward to both hearing from our artists and curators. And then after about 30 minutes, 35 minutes, we'll turn it over to the audience because hopefully you've all had the chance to see the beautiful installation and that you have your own questions that might be generated from the work that you saw and might be also coming out of the discussion that I hope to engage in. So first, I really want to ask Dyani, She had a beautiful title for this show. I think the idea of Sinew is so meaningful on so many different levels, but I just wanted to get it started by asking her if you want to explain how you came to selecting these particular artists, because there are lots of talented artists in the Twin Cities and beyond in the state of Minnesota. So what types of dialogue were you hoping to engender by having these artists share one gallery space?
First of all, thank you everybody for coming tonight. It's exciting. This is an exciting show. It's an exciting day. There's a lot of things going on. We're all really appreciative that you're here. It was actually pretty easy to pick the crew of artists that are in this exhibition. Rachel asked if I would, you know, I really appreciate the fact that Artistry took the time to look at their history of exhibitions, and they recognized the fact that while they had shown a significant amount of female artists, they had not been showing enough artists of color. And with the Gorilla Girls Twin Cities takeover, she saw it as an ideal opportunity to change that. And her and I had, we were at a retreat years ago, 4 or 5 years ago, and so we had met, so she was familiar with me and my work, and she just reached out and said, you know, this Twin Cities takeover is happening, would you like to put together an exhibition of Native artists? And I said, yeah. Very quickly, when I graduated with my bachelor's degree of fine arts from the Institute of American Indian Arts, one of my favorite faculty members, somebody who was much like my dad there, gave me a Gorilla Girls book as my parting gift. And so that was my introduction to the work. And so the opportunity to be able to, at this stage in my career, to put together an exhibition of the amazing female Native artists that I know locally and that speak to the field at large was very exciting for me. We've got some really strong, amazing Native artists in the Twin Cities area, period. There's a really strong representation here in this region. This is Dakota and Ojibwe land base, and we have a rich field of artists that represent that. And the female artists that are here are basically some of the most established, some of the people that have really been putting in a great deal of work and have are really rocking in their careers. And so it was exciting. The only thing that was difficult about it was just picking the five, because, you know, we were limited in space and, you know, what you could do with the exhibition. But narrowing down those five wasn't too hard because these women are also phenomenal in what they do. But what I wanted to do was bring together artists that represent a variety of mediums and a variety of voices in the way that they make their work, because one of the things that was important for me to represent through this exhibition was how much we do and how important those conversations are and how much they reflect and respond to and break out of dialogues that happen in the arts field at large, that they're not just one thing. They're not just two-dimensional arts. They're not just traditional arts. They're not just performing arts, but they're all of those things, right? We've got a really wide variety of types of work in the exhibition, and that's what I wanted to represent was how wide that can be, and even in such a localized space as the Twin Cities.
Yeah, no, I think it's very evident, the breadth of the materials and the kind of media that come to, it's a rich space. One of the things that I was also really taken aback by was, you know, thinking, you know, how this particular group of artists, it seems that a lot of the content of their work seems to be pushing against kind of a long-standing Eurocentric program of assimilation and themes of dissolution and themes of erasure. And there's this kind of long history about cultural negation and kind of directed towards the Native body, and particularly a female Native body. And I was just wondering if maybe you start by explaining maybe in your work about how you push against, how you might see yourself pushing against kind of this trajectory, and how cognizant are you of it in your paintings?
That's a big question. So I guess, and there's a lot of different ways I feel like I could answer that. One of the things that I guess what you're talking about, erasure of personhood, I think about collections, and we've got Jill who works in collections, and most of us have visited collections, probably all of us have visited collections, and we look at the work of our ancestors and how the vast majority of those things, there is no name. Because when works were being collected, they were often seen as craft. The maker was not of value, at least in their eyes, in the way that those were being collected. The way that things were being collected was such a wide variety. Some of it was through trade, but a lot of it was through violent means. There's just such a... the way that our works were in have come to collections is so different than the way that Western artworks have come to collections. So one thing that came to mind immediately is I've made just a small series, I think it's just four pieces now, that's titled Master Study. And it's the only time I've allowed myself to go outside of Lakota culture, and I've paid homage to Navajo weavings. And they're simply paintings that are paintings of weavings. Mm-hmm. And through that, they're all called Master Study 1, 2, 3, and 4. And the idea is that, you know, when you're in art school, you're supposed to, one of the assignments is to do a master study. And so in doing that, you're supposed to pick out this master painter, this master drawer. They're all white male. The old school, the old heads, you know, the ones we all know, and you're supposed to copy that piece as closely as possible. And the idea is that through doing that, you learn through their techniques, you learn about composition, you learn about lighting, you learn about all of these things just by emulating their work. And so thinking about the fact that our masters, because we really do have masters in Native arts field, simply aren't and are not represented in that, you know. So by going back and looking at these amazing weavings and turning them into paintings and simply calling it master study is acknowledging the mastery of artistry that we had in our communities and still have. So that's one way that I've responded to ideas like that.
Yeah, because I was thinking of how perhaps Andrea, in your work, it's particularly the video piece that you have. It seems as if there's objects in the video, but they're not specific to any one particular culture. They look kind of exoticized in a way, but yet they're not kind of this one-to-one correspondence. And I'm wondering, is how do you work with trying to push against this idea that you're exposing, you're having to explain, you're having to, as someone, always having to tell people, well, this is what this means in my culture. They're trying to always kind of elucidate and make visible and then collectible and then knowable and kind of become part of this larger kind of accumulation of knowledge, and which can be turned against people in historically.
I guess I'm totally against framing my work in an anthropological way. Mm-hmm. So I often don't even tell people that I'm Native. I think there's ideas around authenticity, and I think they're very dangerous. So I like to mess with the idea of authenticity and see what happens with it. And it's interesting when I am reviewed and people have the context that I'm Native and female, so they're going to write about my work in a particular way. They're going to anthropologize it. And it's interesting to see what comes back. I had, like, for example, in the video, I made that mask up. That's not from any particular culture. It's not authentic in any way. But I think it's funny to put that out in the world and see what comes back. I like to mess with that idea of authenticity. I don't feel the need to market my identity. I avoid that. But most of my work has to do with storytelling, how we have objects, how we attach stories to them, how we attach authenticity or the ideas of that to an object, and how oftentimes it has nothing to do with that object whatsoever. Material culture moves around a lot faster than
a lot of stories. Sometimes stories lag behind, but someone will get an object and they won't have the story for it, even though it was popular and attached to it at one time. If you think of maybe thousands of years in the future, space aliens might come across all these crucifixes and they have to come up with a story for them. Mm-hmm. I think that there's there's a lot of play and things that would come across objects that had, for a particular moment, a lot of significance that can go away. So I like these desolate seascapes where things wash up on the shore that have no context. I strip them of their context and have them kind of wash up on a shore that's foreign to them. So that's one of the ways of maybe stripping some of that away, stripping some of the narrative away, or taking an object and putting it in like my own mythic landscape is how I sometimes describe it, how I like recontextualize them.
That seems to segue very closely then into the collaborative project between Heid and Louise and Elizabeth, because it seems that both the video and accumulation of objects in that installation is all about that. The material culture, but that it's manifest in so many different ways as you walk through the three different walls even. Do you want to speak to how you conceived of reimagining that installation? Because I understand that it shifts and changes each time that you install it. And then how do you choose which wall or which space is going to be the bearer of which story? I'm just wondering how you worked that out, and if you did it just between in terms of the space or in terms of the stories you're telling with the objects that are both like found objects that don't, they refer a lot to childhood, it seems, and then other very specific objects to like, I know one of the belongs to the Bureau of Indian Affairs. So something that seems to have very specific markers of a certain time and space, and other things that, again, kind of defy time and locale. So I don't know if you want to speak to some of those issues.
No? I guess I'll talk about that a little bit. I don't want to defy what you've said, but it's not that well thought out. and things are discrete and have lives of their own and come together. There's a box, a beautifully constructed box that Louise made that has many objects from her family in it, and it goes with a poem that she made much earlier called Advice to Myself, which is the original Advice to Myself poem that I took to heart and have never really done any housework because she tells us, you know, that we don't have, but she has a perfectly lovely home. But, so the younger sister, I got to take the advice. So that, that piece came into installation that we did at Boakley Gallery last year, and there were layers of installation in the piece. One was the fact that Louise had abstract works, and she had some figural pieces that were constructions in a show that I was curating along with works by her daughters, and by Aza Erdrich and Pallas Erdrich. And Pallas had created a media installation of these phones where you could hear Louise talking, saying things. And at some point, Louise was trying to I could tell she was trying to create a narrative, and I'm like, they're abstractions. You don't have to create a narrative, because my curatorial urge is to not create narrative, to sort of defy context a little bit, even though I work almost always with Native artists. But and so I created an umbrella thing called agency epiphany, because epiphany is where you try to make sense of things that make no sense together. So I guess the only skin over it is this idea of drawing things together for a moment, seeing how they work together, and then walking away. And Elizabeth and I made the film without any sense that it would be installed with the piece. Mm-hmm. It just happened to be shown at the end of that and then was collected separately with this one. They don't really have to be together.
So the idea of kind of bringing things together and telling, you know, telling certain stories, but then trying to defy narratives. It seems that there's a lot of this kind of push and pull. And I was just wondering if we could bring in a curator to the point to kind of think about, you know, you have the awesome authority and the challenge, the privilege of working with objects that have been accessioned into this particular collection that are donations. And are you always thinking in same, maybe probably differently, but thinking about telling stories or not telling stories, trying to create context, but then pushing back in context? It seems like our artists have that flexibility, mm-hmm. but what do you do in a museum context, and what are your responsibilities?
I don't have awesome authority. Maybe I do. I don't know. I didn't think about it that way. No. My goal with my work is to respect the objects and understand that those objects have life and have continued to have life and have had life and have living stories in them. And I try to do the best that I can do to bring those stories to life while still respecting, as Heid said, kind of their own substance in their own way and allowing them to tell stories without, to allow me to try and tell stories that provide context, but at the same time to appreciate them at their own kind of physical space. One of the things that I'm looking forward to doing most recently is this idea of meta-curation, and that's something that I want to do in the next couple of years. I did an install where I think we brought new contemporary work into the EMEA. There was a lot of historic work. I really wanted to bring in contemporary work of wonderful Native artists, mostly women, because 90 to 95 to maybe 98% of art is Native art is made by women. So we brought contemporary, a lot of contemporary pieces in. But the other thing I want to do now is this idea of meta curation is what is my role? What is my role in the curation process? And how can I, without being obnoxious, but how can I situate myself as a curator within the context of what I present? Because it's never a straight, you know, a playing field in which we are creating this story, we are creating these stories in a vacuum, but I am emplaced in it. And my story and the history, the institution story is a part of all of those objects. So how can we bring those histories to life in our curation to really explore how we understand those objects and what we think we know about those objects, but we really don't know about those objects and what we do know. So that's what I'm looking forward to.
I was, as a follow-up, I know that the Gorilla Girls had done a project in Mia's space. It's a projection that's in the kind of entryway right now that I understand will move around institution and be used in different ways. Mm-hmm. And they bring out a lot of statistics representing kind of the dearth of non-white and non-male artists mm-hmm. overall. And another thing they bring up is kind of this dichotomy, which is a lot of dichotomies are false dichotomies about the, you know, the art as fine art versus craft. Mm-hmm. And I was just wondering if in your work, I mean, is a part of what you're trying to do is kind of give names and readdress those? Do you do that kind of, you know, history, that historical research of trying to reattach a name with an object? Right. And how important is that art historically?
Well, so I'm trained as an anthropologist, so that's a little bit of problematic because in many ways those the objects themselves weren't necessarily the objects being made by a particular maker. It was very clear within that community who were the best master artists mm-hmm. in that community. And they knew in their community without necessarily having to sign their name on it. People knew who the masters were, and it wasn't necessarily about the individual artist as we understand mm-hmm. it now. But at the same time, now I'm not an anthropologist anymore, and I'm in an art museum, and I understand the legacy and the history of Native art as being Native people as anonymous, mm-hmm. as craftspeople, as being based on doing things based on tradition. And so the show that is going to happen in 2018 is to highlight women, Native women artists who from as early as 1830s, we have 1820s, 1830s of known women artists and connect those objects to known women in the within their communities so that we can actually identify in Western terms, mm-hmm. What signifies a master artist and bring that particular person more fully into our understanding. So absolutely bringing that person back to the object.
And that also the idea of the role of the artist who was mother and woman, I thought was really poignant in what Louise, you mentioned in an artist statement that I'd like to bring up. You wrote that it is wonderful to work with other Native women, or she's reflecting on the opportunity to be a part of this group show, and she writes, it's wonderful to work with other Native women and Native mothers because the dichotomy between motherhood and art does not exist as conflict. Our mothers created at all times and included us in their work. think that's an amazing ideal for me. It would be such an ideal space to be in. And so I'm just wondering, as a mother and somebody who works and thinking that they would be absolutely sympathetic in with one another. So I'm just wondering how, you know, feeling that and inheriting that and maybe being able to work with it, but how much of it is this? I mean, how you know, women, Native women, were perhaps historically able to make that work, where women didn't have to choose between roles, but in a true day-to-day life, you know, how much is that really viable? And is it really difficult still to negotiate, especially with kind of our focus on nuclear families and the way that we have kind of set up our 21st century culture? So it seemed like a beautiful sentiment, but I'm just really unsure if how true you found that in your working life.
True and difficult. Our mother, Rita, really did include us in her day-to-day art. I have a picture of Heid looking at all the drawings that she made of her children. She continued to draw. She continued to make art. She sewed for us. She did everything that she did was somehow a work of art for us. But she made it for her children. But that doesn't invalidate it as a work of art. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And by the way, thank you again all for being here. Thank you, Gorilla Girls. This is so cool. Heid and I live about a block and a half apart. And our sister Angela lives another block and a half apart. My three daughters, one of whom is a visual artist, the other a video artist, live next door. We still live in this, and we still live in this situation that is maybe uncommon, but it's, and maybe it has nothing to do with culture. I don't know. Maybe it's a family choice, you know. But that's how we live. And I think back to our moms, our great-grandmother. And as we were talking here, I was thinking about how in order to support her family, she sold, as you know from putting together this show, she sold everything she made. She was a fantastic bead worker, and she sold everything to people who rode the train, which is now the Empire Builder, between Rugby and Montana. So she rode that train back and forth, and she sold her beadwork. We have maybe two pieces of beadwork from her. So, but we have them, we know who did them, and they're of incredible significance to us. That's all that's left of all of the extraordinary work that she did for us, you know. And our mother included us at all times with her doing things. I tried to include my babies, but at a certain point, it absolutely becomes impossible. At that point, I've always relied on other women, mm-hmm. and I've always been helped by other women. Mm-hmm. So
that's wonderful. So I have again, kind of working with the video piece, which is absolutely stunning. So I was interested, though, in advice to myself, resistance. And so, you know, thinking about the role of women, and it's interesting because none of the work is explicitly about the body, because a lot of feminist work often was a reclamation of the body and saying, I'm not going to be objectified, I'm going to be my own subject and object. And it's interesting in the work, the thing that's closest to the body is the bear in that piece. So I'm wondering if you might, I don't know if Elizabeth, you want to speak to that, is because you're the cinematographer, mm-hmm. and the choice of kind of presenting what you present and what you don't present, and where's the points of resistance in that film?
Mm-hmm. Well, this whole experience was incredible, collaborating with Heid and Louise, and just thinking about motherhood in that sense too. When we first filmed the footage, it was what, 2 or 3 winters ago, mm-hmm. we did everything was reversed in how I normally would shoot a film. So first we had the footage and we kind of knew that we were going to do something yeah. with it.
At least one thing. We have 2.5 hours.
Yeah. Louise is like, I'm going to dress up like a bear. And there is a huge pile of snow that's a cake that I don't let anyone touch because we're going to film me with the sword getting it.
She has a black belt. That's a real sword.
So then,
Kung Fu.
So then fast forward to a year later, and I remember it was December 29th because I was 9 months pregnant and I was like, I'm gonna pop at any second. But it was so wonderful and peaceful because Louise had us over and we went to her space and recorded poetry, and I was like, oh my god, I get to be like just like listening to Louise read poetry and listening to the snow creak outside. And I don't know, it was really interesting how that project just was meant to be and how things kept falling in place, even though, you know, they were years apart. Mm-hmm. And then relying on other women, I was editing, I think I was like 4 weeks post. Yeah. Postpartum, and Heid came over and was holding my baby and we were editing together, so the whole thing was really special as far as motherhood and women working together and collaborating for artists. I can't remember the question that you asked.
Well, thinking about, you know, where the feminine element is in that. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's very present, but I was thinking about the term yeah. resist, which is the repeated yeah. word. And
there's such a, I mean, it's in the strength, it's in the power. I think the moment, there's a couple pivotal moments for me in that one. And one, it's she's on the sidewalk and she's kind of doing her motions and she just stops and freezes at the camera. Mm-hmm. That's one of them. And another frozen point is when she raises her sword. And that's a really powerful moment to me. And then also at the end when it has the reversal of the mask going back into the, mm-hmm. I mean, I don't know if you really noticed that it's reversed, but the image is all, instead of the mask is coming out, it's going back in and you see the face mm-hmm. behind the mask. And that wasn't my idea.
Collaboration.
Yeah, so for those 3 points, I think were mine.
Okay. Because mm-hmm. one of the things that I was thinking of too then, I saw this in Andrea's work, but maybe I'm reading too much into it. But you know, thinking about you know, the loss of identity and the reclamation of identity, and how is that something that because there's a beautiful poem that is posted next to your piece that Clarence, another artist, wrote about it, which is it's just quite a beautiful, beautiful. Kind of interpretation of your of the work, and it seems that it's really about losing and about taking away. And again, I guess I'm just going back to maybe one of these points about thinking about: are you cognizant of what you put out in the world as being potentially assimilated into something else or reappropriated? And I guess I'm thinking about it writ large more about what has happened in the trajectory of Native American art, which is about your work too, Dyani, where the tropes of Native American art, you know, was adopted by 20th century Americanist European painters and all of a sudden made to be this new primitive element. But thinking about that, you know, or how cognizant are you always about this question about assimilation and kind of and loss culturally? And if you bear some kind of sense that you have some kind of it's your responsibility or your job to. I'm just wondering if you feel that, or if it's your work is just it may be about that because you've read so much and thought so deeply about some of those issues. So I guess it's a question for maybe either Andrea or Dyani, if you feel comfortable.
Wanna go first?
Sure. Well, I guess I could talk a little bit just about identity in general. I wrote a really short review of this show, which apparently is okay for the circle. Mm-hmm. Back in 1992, it was the quincentennial of Columbus's landing, 1492. So at that time, a number of curators were responding to that and wanted to have that conversation about colonization, about post-colonization, and about what it means. So there was a number of shows that were that dealt with that theme. Artist James Luna, who's a performance artist, decided to protest it in a really big way. He said, he's a performance artist, so he said, my performance is Call Me in 93. You all of a sudden care. Did you care last year? And will you care in 93? Brilliant. It was a very brilliant piece. So the Gorilla Girls are in town, and there's a lot of sympathetic programming going on right now around the Gorilla Girls being here. Will everyone care when they leave? It's a question that I've been asking myself a lot lately. Also, the idea of female Native artists from the Twin Cities is dividing us up into groups like that, mm-hmm. is something that is afforded to minorities. Mm-hmm. You don't go into the contemporary collection at the MIA and say, you know, white heterosexual male collection. Right. But if you pull all of the Natives out, if you pull all of the African Americans out and put them in ethnographic collections, you reserve the contemporary galleries for like white guys. And that's what's happened. So it's something that I have been grappling with a lot lately. It's something where the context can be very heavy. It can be almost burdensome to the work. It's something that I find myself always having to address. Mm-hmm. I go back again and again and again to the themes of traditional versus contemporary and how I don't get to not talk about that. Mm-hmm. Right. That's something that I always have to bring up, and I always have to address authenticity. I always have to authenticate myself for people because I also don't look very Native. So I am constantly in this position where I look at some of my peers that can take on whatever topic they want. They have, they can be authors and they can chase down things and they can be authorities over their subject matter. And I am kind of a little jealous that everything I do has to be from the Native American perspective. And I kind of
resent it.
Covet that freedom of of being out of that context. So I've kind of walked on both sides. Mm-hmm. And for a while, people were saying, you're the type of artist that wants it both ways. And I would say, yeah, I am. I want it both ways.
So. I think they're very good, deep issues that I, too, was wanting to ask. Like, for example, if this show traveled to some place like Mia, you know, would this be a show closer to the Native American galleries? Or is this a show that should be in the contemporary art galleries? And is that an issue you have to take into consideration, even with your upcoming shows, how you position it even physically in a space like the Minneapolis Institute of Arts?
Mm-hmm. Yes, it could be in both. So it depends on the curator, but it could absolutely live in both places. I think that actually Mia is doing an okay job and is understanding in terms of their contemporary work of trying to incorporate many different people other than white men into their contemporary collection. I'm hoping that there is a new curator that's going to be coming, but I'm always pitching wonderful contemporary Native artists that would look as beautiful in the third floor at Mia as they do in any other gallery. So that, yes, the answer is yes. I think that it's not exclusive either. Mm-hmm. I think that the work of Andrea's works beautifully with the Native American galleries, and I think it works beautifully up in the third floor as well as all of the other artists here.
First, I want to thank you ladies for what you're doing. I think it's an amazing concept to bring this to light in the context of fine art. You know, I've kind of been an advocate for, you know, the works of my aunts and whatnot to be in galleries and not just trinket attractions in tourist towns in Minnesota. So it's an awesome leap. I guess listening to Andrea brings me back to undergrad and when I first heard the term ideologically corrupt, where as they're exterminating us, they're trying to gather anything without European influence. Mm-hmm. And as quick as possible before we're gone. And we've been addressing that we're still here for so long. And I'm kind of answering my own question that we just got to keep digging in. But where do you guys see that, I guess, paradigm shift where our inherent value is just as important in our work being contemporary art, you know, like, I guess, Pollock adopting the policies, and they've been there for a long time as their native inspirations. But I guess, where do you see what needs to happen for that pivot to switch, I guess? What needs to happen? Because I guess that's where I'm at a loss.
Define the pivot to switch.
Where our whole spectrum is in that contemporary collection, not just the native, this is a native collection, but where the most amazing beadwork or quillwork is in that contemporary collection of fine art. Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, there are ethereal values in that, like there are in contemporary art. You know, we have all the same. When I write it down and try to analyze what the difference is, I can't find it. So it's like, how do you open the eyes of others to see that? You know, I've been trying for years, and a ton of native artists have. I don't know what that switch is, I guess.
I'll respond to that first, if that's okay. I obviously don't have the answer because I can't tell the future. But my immediate answer is human growth. Simply on the fact that, you know, we're slow. We're slow to learn as humans, and it's taking us an incredibly long time to learn how to value one another on an equal level. And these shows, even though I completely understand and get and have all those mental battles that Andrea brought up, I think that the show, you know, what has made art history, with the capital A, with the fine art history, has been, as we know, and why we're here tonight, has been made up and defined by and populated by predominantly European males. And because of that, shows like this, even though for the time being they may separate, I feel like they're extremely important because they've been separated and for time immemorial without the title, without it specifically calling out, hey, white dudes only. These shows specifically call out, but they give opportunity and voice, and they highlight, hey, we've got some amazing work over here too, and you should check it out. You need to see it, and you need to understand why it's important, how it relates to the rest of the work. I feel like they give opportunity to give voice, and in time, as more curators, more academics, more artists, and more people have exposure to a wider narrative, then growth can happen. But until we push against, and until, you know, we have to keep pushing against, we have to keep screaming at the top of our lungs, we have to keep making amazing work and responding to. And I feel like, you know, it's going to take time, because we've got all of these, you know, centuries worth of what has not been inclusive, and it's going to take time, and it's going to take shifts in institutions, the people that are working there now, and people that are coming up into working those spaces, and having younger generations of thought that recognize the fact that women and LGBT community and youth and all of those things have valid voices as well. That will change within generations as well. And so there's so much, I feel like, that's at play with that, that I feel like it's going to take artists like yourself and myself who call out and say, hey, did you know that that really pretty craft that you think is, you know, just beautiful speaks abstractly in the same symbolic way that this painting over here does. Did you know that? Did you know that there's actually like cosmologies built into that piece? Did you know that it speaks to generations worth of, there's a giant lack of knowledge and information behind that and why, you know, so when people see it, oh, that's really great, put it in the, you know, craft, anthropological, they don't know the stories and the histories that come with it. So they've not been able to, most people have not been able to see that. A lot of those works speak in an abstract, symbolic way in the same way that the generations of Western art have done the same thing. I remember the day that that dawned on me in grad school, I remember walking down the street in Madison being like, it's the same thing, completely different context, but generations of conversations between artists. Mm-hmm. Totally different context, totally different reasons why, but generations of artists responding to generations of artists, generations of people responding to generations of people and artistic output, aesthetic symbolism of our lived experiences.
I was just curious, hearing you mention that there was the sword involved with the video, that you do have a black belt, that I'm wondering, well, what kind of other, like, do you think that those kind of influences, either by other cultures that contribute to your work, that it would just kind of be defaulted, even though there's those influences, like say someone's very heavily, like a piece is very heavily influenced by Eastern culture, would it still like be considered native culture? And that's kind of, and just what your opinion on how, where that draws the line of when it's going to be considered native rather than just be considered contemporary, I guess. Extending on the theme we're going with, I guess.
All right, I've got to say something first. I don't have a black belt, okay? I wish that I don't have it. I was
not
working.
The only fiction
okay.
writer.
Yeah, okay, that's, I don't, but I was working and I was taking a test in a sword form. So, all right, working on that. One thing I have to say, because I think that this is primarily why I'm sitting here and why the other artists and everyone who's here is here, is because in art there is an enormous component of human joy. It's art to me is it's conflict, it's anguish, it's universal, and it's joy. You know, there's an incredible amount of devotion and joy that goes into making a work of art, and that is what I feel authenticates each one of us. So that when we divide up into cultural pieces, bits and pieces, now, where the authenticity is coming from is from the depth of commitment of the individual.
I had a question about the quilting. I don't have a very big knowledge of Native American art other than to the oh, shiny pretty. It's gorgeous, but I don't really know much about it. And I was wondering if you could tell me about quilting and Native American art. Is that something that you grew up with, or historically, how does it play in?
Speaking specifically to the pieces that are in the show, though?
Yes, Maggie's.
No, that's Carolyn's work. So, yeah, I guess we could go either Carolyn's route or Maggie's route. Carolyn's route is there's quilting in the fact that she's using fabric, but I think the more specific textile reference in those pieces is the weaving that's in there. And so her pieces are the three textile pieces that are part painting, part textile sewing, quilting, kind of, and weaving, and I love that it kind of like wraps up all those art history references and mediums and practices and trajectories we were talking about all in one. So for Carolyn, it specifically, she's Navajo, and so it was important for her, but she lives here, and she's also, you know, like all of us on this panel, also mixed. And so that was a part of her artistic journey too, was that she went home to Navajo Reservation and learned from relatives how to weave. And she uses that in her practice now. But it's, if you've noticed, I mean, it's like part of the story. Mm-hmm. It's not all of the story for her, it's a part of her story. And she's got such worldly concepts that she's tackling in those pieces. And I love the fact that she's looking at the global issues and how those global issues really come back to our Native communities as well. So it's they go from the super personal to the super global, all in one piece, and then bring in issues of art history in such a great, slick way through the mixing of mediums. Mm-hmm. And then quilting in general, I mean, there's a long history of quilt making in Native communities, and actually a lot of that comes out of boarding school era, and that it was taught in residential schools. But that's one of those things that may have come from that place, but has been completely like brought into and made a part of our artistic production and communities, and the way that we gift each other and honor each other and remember each other and bring babies into the world. I mean, it's one of those things that like it may have come from that place, but it is like it does have a huge role in our communities. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And there's some amazing quilt artists in the Native communities and exhibitions. I think there's one in Rapid City right now, actually.
Well, it's sort of self-serving, but there's there's Boakley Gallery, of course, who works with some of the premier artists. I don't even know what that word means, but we use it. but you know, great artists like Dyani and Andrea, and Elsa has shown Louise's work. Her first show was there, our first show. But there's All My Relations Art on Franklin, which is the only contemporary Native art gallery that's run by, for, and with Native people. And it's the only contemporary, solely contemporary in the Upper Midwest still, too. So, and then there's Two Rivers Gallery, which is at the Indian Center, which had a reopening and rededication to emerging and community art and other types of visual exhibits. They've been wonderful things that have been happening. And last time we had an opening, we had a crawl with Mia too. So it was just, there's a huge scene. And Andrea wrote a great article about the Native art scene in the Twin Cities recently. And you can see it online if you want to see it. If you just Google Andrea Carlson Native art, now you're going to find her there, no matter if she wants to be there or not.
Dangerous Google search.
Even with her mask on.
And Birch Bark Bookstore, where there's amazing artists and crafts and books.
Literature. Yeah. But it does, it's by the Boakley Gallery. So
Same block.
Kenwood neighborhood. Great. Well, thank you so much for coming. Thanks for the great questions. And thank you, panelists. This was a really informative, enjoyable evening. Yeah.